Okay, welcome. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Howard Combs from San Jose State, and I have the pleasure of chairing this afternoon session. We have four very interesting presentations from four distinguished guests. So we're going to try to stay on time, so we'll have a break around 3 o'clock for about 15 minutes. So we have two presentations and then the break and then two additional presentations. So I appreciate the speakers being here on time and being ready. So let's go ahead and start, maybe a minute or two early, but that's just fine. So our first speaker will be speaking on KMOOC, recent progress, current status, and future prospects. And our speaker is Hoon-Ju Soo, from Director of the Office of KMOOC Planning, Office of Public Relations and International Affairs, National Institute of Lifelong Education, the Republic of Korea. Certainly appreciate him coming today and looking forward to a wonderful presentation. Thank you very much.
Yes, nice to meet you, and it is my great pleasure to be here and present the KMOOC case for all of you. First, I just briefly mentioned my organizations which I belong to. The National Institute for Lifelong Education is as a public institution under which is funded and sponsored and also controlled by the Ministry of Education, the Republic of Korea. So half is kind of public servant and half is civilians, but usually I think they're civilians. So today, What I'm going to talk about is the recent developments of KMOOC and future prospects. So I think you all know the definitions of MOOC. So I just skip this one. First, I want to talk about the introducing why South Korea introduced KMOOC in Korea. The first one is innovating teaching learning method in higher education and respond proactive stance against the international proliferation of MOOCs. Around 2012, in the United States, edX and Coursera, they start the MOOC is kind of campaigns. So the South Koreans, they want to lead some like sectors, in this case, the MOOC movement. So the South Korean government, they like suggest and promote the South Korean universities to adopt the MOOC trends. And thirdly, realize equal opportunities for higher education. So during the last 20 to 30 years, many South Koreans, they want like enter like high quality universities to get a degree from the universities. For example, I graduate from the Goryeo universities, and also if you have a high quality educations, you can get a good job in the job market. So most Korean people, they want to get like a good university certificates, but most of them, they haven't entered the high quality universities. So like a university education is exclusive for like a high income families or people would have like a special talents. And finally, the reason why the South Korean government introduced the KMOOC is to establish a foundations for lifelong learning, lifelong learning in the era of Home 100. So the South Korea, during the last 10 years, rapidly South Korean society experienced low births and aging society. So now we have to prepare for the low births and aging society. So the South Korean government, they introduced the MOOC systems. And I just show this is just for your references. The faces, some faces of e-learning development in South Korea. First, IT-based education, and then e-learning and U-learning, ubiquitous learning, and the smart learning. Now, flipped learning, K-MOOC. Yes. And now, I want to explain some visions and policy goals and strategies of K-MOOC. The vision of the K-MOOC is innovation in college or higher education through open higher education systems. And it has three policy goals. First one is innovation in higher education through access to best quality lectures. The second, offering higher education opportunities. And thirdly, forming a foundations for lifelong learning on higher education. And in order to achieve that policy goals and visions, we have four strategies. We try to expand the participating institutions or organizations after developing the K-MOOC as a competent leading brand. And secondly, we are trying to respect universities' autonomy and diversities because we try to promote voluntarily participating in K-MOOC systems. So we try to minimally intervene the university's efforts to develop the K-MOOC contents. And thirdly, considering to offer additional service by stage by stage, after forming a firm foundation through government support. For example, around 2018, we will introduce, we will connect K-MOOC systems to credit bank systems and learning portfolio account systems. And finally, we are developing the K-MOOC systems into this kind of global platforms. Through K-MOOC, developing countries, they can access to the know-how or knowledge of Korean economic development during the last 40 to 60 years. So it's kind of official development ODA, official development assistant aid platforms. Yes, let's look at the implementation structure of K-MOOCs. K-MOOC is open for the audience. I say I write citizens, but citizen means include from the middle school students, high school students, till range to the old peoples. And also providers. We have now 20 participating universities and institutions. And also, the core project is controlled by the Ministry of Education, and the NILE, which I belong to, is operating the whole project. And also, we have cooperation organizations such as CARIS. They supervise the convergent development of OCW contents, and Korean Council for University Education, they connect networking between universities. And also education broadcasting systems of South Korea, they support the development of MOOC contents and courses, materials. And we also have strategic roadmap to develop the K-MOOCs. From 2015 to 2017, we try to introduce and consolidate our K-MOOC systems. And then from 2018 to 2020, we will globalize our contents and platforms. And then finally, 2021 onward, we are constructing the open higher education systems by adding, as I mentioned, credit bank systems and learning account, learning portfolio account systems. So eventually, we are considering development of ecosystems centered around KMOOC, like this. So we are expecting having this kind of potential impacts and contributions. First, launching of KMOOC leading to the global paradigm shift with Korean wave in education, and enhancing competitive of higher education in South Korea, and thereby contributing towards national human resource development. And then this lead to equal opportunities in higher education. That means democratizing or equalizing the opportunity to approach the university education. And then so encourage universities to innovate themselves through providing them with quality teaching and learning method. And then finally, enhancing social contribution of higher education in individual and national matters. So last October, we launched the KMOOC systems. Now around 10 months, right? Around 10 months now, yes. Last year, we have 10 participating universities, and then they developed 29 MOOC contents, and now we evaluate the launching of KMOOC is quite successfully, and now quite stabilized systems. You know, like this, last October 14th, 2015, we officially launched the KMOOC systems. And also we have like web platform front gate designs here. Here is the participating universities, including almost top 10 universities in South Korea. So this can like attract many South Korean audiences to the KMOOC platforms. And this slide shows some of the subjects titles. For example, like education psychology and experience design, and also here is information sociology and understanding of universe, and also global citizen educations, and also we have creative ideations. The professor in charge of that subject, last year he got around $300 from his lectures when he invited, as a guest invited to like class. Last year, just $300. But now, he got $3,000 from his lectures. So I can't believe it. But he said his like a kind of status of his status quite highly improved. Yes. So I think it's kind of effect of KMOOC on the professors at the universities. And 2015, as I said before, we provide 29 courses offered by 10 universities. And this year, now we have 128 lectures. So the subjects of all lectures covers from language literature to biology. So we have a diversity of lectures. Last year, we have small number of lectures, so we couldn't have any kind of diversity. So the learners, they asked us, demand, please expand the diversity of lectures and also increase the number of lectures. So we reflect on their demand. This year, we increase the number of lectures, also the diversity of lectures. Next year, maybe if we get enough fund from the government, next year we get around 300 lectures, I hope. Yeah. So we are using the OpenEdX based localized for Korean audience platforms, so you can easily exchange our contents with other MOOCs, such as Thai and Indonesia MOOCs, and also JMOOCs and ShetangX MOOCs. And also, of course, we can exchange the edX and Coursera. Yes, so we have kind of like a compatibility with other MOOCs. Yes. And this year we have KMOOC platform has new features under development. We will, at the end of this October, introduce KMOOC Insight. Original version of edX platform has provided some kind of statistical information to the audience. But we are using the OpenEdX systems. So OpenEdX platforms doesn't provide the statistical information to our audience. So this year we embedded that systems to our platform. So at the end of this October, the learners, they can get some information from our platforms. And also from this year on, we provide multilingual platforms. Currently, almost every lecturers have English transcripts, captions, service. But from next year, maybe almost every lecturers have English and Korean transcripts. So you can easily access to our lecture contents. Yes, this is almost same features as the edX platform. So just skip. Yeah. So and now, we are considering the very the importance of quality control. So we have two mechanisms to manage and control the quality of the MOOC lectures. The first one is we minimally provide the guidelines for quality control and constant quality check performed through operation of monitoring groups. So we have two it's kind of screening systems. First is the participating university, they have their own like a screening committees for quality controls. And also nationally, the Ministry of Education and NIAL has national committee for quality controls. So we have the participating universities, they have to go through the two-staged quality control systems. So it can, we believe, secure the high quality of lectures. And second is we have done the annual inspections. Result of first year's inspection integrated into second year's. So we can if a participating universities get a high assessment result, we give some more fund, and other participating universities get a poor result, we downgrade, decrease their fund. So it's kind of comparative, but still we try to minimally modify the funding. So, and now I talk about the overall outcomes of KMOOCs. As of 27th July, 26th, accumulated number of learners now, visitors is 1,375,000, and learners now 117,000, and registered learners is 81,113. So around maybe less than 10% registered finished their courses. And also, if we look at the age groups of KMOOC learners, mostly 20s and 30s major learners for KMOOCs. And also participating institutions, at first 10 universities participating in K-MOOCs, now 39 universities participating in K-MOOC systems. Actually, they provide this kind of source of K-MOOC contents. And courses from starts 27 to 29, now this year 128. Next year, we hope, as I said before, 300 K-MOOC courses would be provided on by K-MOOC platforms. And also, who are the K-MOOC registered learners? You look at in details. By age groups, usually most of them is from 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s. But if you look at the below 20s, still around 10% of learners from middle and high school students. So we ask, why do they take the K-MOOC? Maybe the level of contents of K-MOOC should be difficult for them. But they answered, they can establish their career track for their future. And also, they can use the K-MOOC contents for their university entrance. They can write down their history of taking the K-MOOC contents for their entering or top universities examinations. So it's kind of, we hope they don't, but the Korean middle school and high school students, especially foreign high school students, they want to use the K-MOOC as their qualifications for university entrance examinations. Yes, and let's look at the learner survey more in details. The survey, yes. So, what was your purpose in taking K-MOOC courses? 66% of people answered intellectual curiosity, but interestingly, 16% of respondents answered major related basic and intensive learnings. And also 9% they said they answered enhancing vocational skills. So from next year, we will change the first category of answer intellectual curiosity into other more detailed the questions. So from intellectual curiosity, we couldn't analyze the details of the answers, so we are going to change. And also, we ask, did you complete the course? So around 65% of people, they don't finish the course. So I think this is kind of like a same common problem to the MOOC platforms, edX, or if the TaiMOOC officially launched it, maybe I think the TaiMOOC also has this kind of common problems. So we are trying to analyze why do they didn't finish their courses. So, and we also asked why do they do not finish, complete the courses. The first one is interesting, lack of wills. And second is lack of time. And third one is contents too difficult to follow. So and also too much workload. So that has implied some things to us. Yes. And also we ask, did you achieve your personal goals for taking the course? Yes, 70% of people answered very helpful. And also, what did you like the best in K-MOOC? Most people answered, 75% of people, course contents. So we are proud of providing quality lectures to our audiences. And then what do you find most important and needed when taking a K-MOOC courses? Most people said diversity of contents, course contents, and also interaction among learners, and also feedback from instructors, teaching assistants. So from this, we can abstract that most learners, they want like interactive aspects of KMOOC. Yes. Yes. Now look at the KMOOC in practice. Some universities, they use the KMOOC as their like academic credit recognitions, or for example, the Seoul National Universities, two courses developed and serviced in 2015, Introduction to Economics and Space and Life, used in 2015 winter semester in a form of flipped learning for the regular semester course, converging that natural science tools, and using chroma key and 3D technology, a vast amount of interactive contents are provided to the learners, which in turn stimulates learners' interest. And also Gyeonggi University, they provide a global civic education, subtitle Living in the Global Commons Society, being shared with the National University of East Timor. So MOOC-based contents, international contents exchange is now in practice. So that's quite interesting development. And also, as I mentioned, some high schools, they use the KMOOC contents. For example, Daewon Foreign Language High School, they using KMOOC for flipped learning in special lectures. And also, Hanyang University high schools, they using KMOOC for extracurricular activities. For example, in detail, around 10 second year students formed a study circle named Curious, in which they individually and voluntarily took Seoul National University KMOOC course, Space and Life, shared their study findings with each other. It's kind of community of practice at the high school levels. So that is also interesting development of KMOOC. So we are considering why the KMOOC is relatively successful, has been successful. Its first one is cooperation between the government and universities. And second is, as you know well, South Korea has a quality ICT environment, and also ties to lifelong learning policies, and also finally in connection with higher education structural reforms. But still, we have a challenge, problems, issues, need for constant financial and technical investments. This year, we tried to get more fund for our project. And also, we tried to persuade the government department in charge of budget plannings. But it is very difficult. Yes, but we will try to get the original target fund. And also, we have still difficulties in securing high-quality contents. And also, we have the copyright issues, quite serious issues. And also, we have sustainabilities. So how can we continue to like high-quality lectures and also get like a sustainable fund for our project? But still, but we have some bright aspects of KMOOC developments in the future. First, we are developing the multilingual services, and also the credit transfer between Asian countries. We are, for example, I have contact with the person in charge of Thai MOOC. So Thai MOOC will establish some contents on its platforms, we will exchange the MOOC contents. So we hope so. And also, we are actively network and cooperation based on KMOOC. So many Asian countries, for example, Myanmar, Indonesia, Malaysia, they showed their interest in like connecting the MOOC contents. And also, we think the MOOC can be as a public diplomacy tools for enhancing national brands or reputations. So we are going to upload and develop and upload about Korea contents, including Korean economic development, for example, the Semau movement. And so the developing countries or underdeveloping countries, they can use these contents. And finally, we are going to develop a profit models, because the government, they cannot continue to support or fund this project. So from this year on till next year, we are going to develop the profit models. So maybe year 2018, maybe just the government, they fund the operation of platforms just only, and then the universities, they develop their own contents and get their profit from the learners after they finish their courses. Yes, thank you.
Did older students finish more commonly than younger students, or do you think there was much of a difference? What would you say about older students' reaction to this compared to younger ones? Because we're all going to be in a situation, many of us, the United States included, where we have a lot of
older students that we call non-traditional students, but older students taking this kind of a format. What can we learn from Korea's example in that regard?
We haven't analyzed the attitudes of the older people between older people and the younger people. So it is hard to answer your questions. But the Korean older people, especially I think at the age of 50s, they have I think they were born around 60s, 1960s. So they get higher educations, other age groups, so they still have kind of intellectual curiosity. Also, they have vocational knowledge to prepare for their older life. So maybe I think that causes some different aspects between two age groups.
Okay, thank you. Do we have some other questions for our speaker? Okay, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation.
Thank you very much.
Okay, our second presentation today is entitled The Disruptions of App-Enabled Learning. It's by Professor John G. Hedberg, adjunct professor of education from Macquarie University in Australia. And we also appreciate him coming and sharing interesting ideas with us today. So we'll turn it over to you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. At the outset, can I warn everybody that I'm not talking about a big system. I'm talking about the sort of technology systems that teachers in their classrooms, when they band together, are interested in working with and actually generating resources within the framework that they have available. I'd like to acknowledge at the beginning some of this work that I'm talking about today was actually undertaken by a former graduate student of mine, Dr. Michael Stevenson, who has since graduated because what he did was a good study. So I'd like to share it with you because I think it provides some interesting examples of what you might want to try with groups of teachers or groups with student teachers in the classroom. Let's think about what the claims were for this device called the internet. It's interesting if you go back just a few years. I mean, we were all alive in 2004, although some of you look very close to being about three. The whole idea is that since that time, we've got people predicting that this great thing called the internet would be to release the possibility of new devices, smart devices that would be akin to supercomputers, and that these early devices, the smart telephones, were really just tools for consumption, not for creation and generating new resources. And it's that I would like to explore in the context of this presentation. I think it's important to look about what digital technologies do for us. And in Howard's presentation this morning, he talked about the Christensen definition, where a new technological innovation comes along and it displaces an existing dominant technology. And I like to think of this fairly clearly within most of our lifetimes as something like this is happening. Originally, something comes along, and as it gets refined and improved, the quality of the capability of that tool increases. But what happens when something comes along? It starts with sort of very mediocre quality, if rather poor quality, and it cuts across and eventually takes over from what high quality resources can use. Let me just give you a simple example. Can anybody remember Polaroids? A few people are admitting it, thank you. They started off as poor quality image ways of presenting images. But the interesting thing about Polaroids is that they never actually crossed over and ever produced high quality images. But the other technology called digital imaging did in fact do that. The early cameras that we had were of poor quality, and as time went on, the cameras got more and more megapixels per image, and so we end up with increased quality of image. In fact, the other thing that happened as we changed these technologies was that the way in which we use the technologies could be changed. And as we started to use digital technologies, we didn't have to go to the corner store and get it developed anymore. We didn't have to pay to have it printed off because we could do it all ourselves on colored printers. And in fact, how many of you actually get printed photographs of the shots you take on your smartphone? Not many. Not nowadays. You do. Oh, okay, there's a couple of people that's saying they still like to touch something. But the thing is that a lot of us share those images directly with other people via the internet. And so that they don't necessarily turn into a printed form. So if you think about what digital technologies have done to the simple production of images of the world, it's been fairly major in the way in which we can A, create them, and B, share them, and C, then learn from them and use them the resources. So we can now do things that we couldn't do before. The interesting thing, too, is if you think about it, a lot of people never use fax machines for the same reason nowadays. They simply take a high-quality image with their phone and send it as an image. So it's changed the way a lot of things happen. And I'd like you to think of that idea as we talk about educational applications, because what some of these technologies have done is give us the access to new ways of sharing and creating ideas. So what we've got now is on our smart device, we've got complete productivity products. So we don't have to actually go to we don't have any desktop machines around here. You don't have to go to a desktop machine. You've got the whole access to everything. You've got not only office productivity, but you've got video editing, audio recording, and so it goes on. And you don't even need the physical connection. I could be doing all of this, presenting all of this with a Wi-Fi connection from my computer at home. So this change in technologies changes a lot about how we might go about things. If you think about what's happened over the last, I'd say about 20 years, we started off with PCs, and eventually we started with graphical user interfaces, and then along came the web. Can anybody remember the year? Was anybody alive in 1993? Some of us admit it. Yeah, so it's not very long. I mean, it's within everybody's lifetime. And then that was improved by the interactive web, which became Web 2. And then in more recent times, the idea of cloud storage and cloud mobility that enabled us to move resources around and store them in a lot of different places. Now, this is not a very good image, but showing the actual sales of desktops, portables, tablets, and emerging desktops, which are the devices that are mixtures. If you look at it, this only goes up to 2017, but increasingly the prediction is that desktops will disappear, and that increasingly people will be using mobiles and more recently smart devices. And if you actually look at current figures, that's pretty much what's happened. The other thing too is with the current mobile technology or smart technology, we have actually a lot of possibilities. And in fact, it's only in the last quarter of the sales figures have started to go down. But they're still fairly popular. Actually, I heard just the other day that it's the end of next month will be the last month they produce VHS recorders. So if you want to get a VHS recorder, you better go out there and buy it soon, because you won't be able to buy them after that, except as secondhand devices. So we have a high saturation of smartphones, and that means that we now think of the devices that we use for most of our activities for learning and for sharing look something more like this. And there's even combinations of hybrid devices. But let's think about what gets disrupted. If you think about it, it's the tools that we play with, the changes from analog to digital, from the sort of labs of equipment that we provide currently in institutions through to student-provided devices. How many people go to a university or a college that is getting rid of their computer labs? Anybody? No, the computer labs you have at the college. Nobody? Oh, that's interesting. Because what's happening in a lot of places is that people are not providing the access to the computers. They'll provide some tablet PCs or some shareable devices, and that, that any room can be turned into a technology-enabled classroom. So I think that's quite interesting. So that the tools of task and access to the tools has changed. The process that we use, I think I've illustrated that with digital photography. And the only thing that we've got to separate out is, and this is, I think, the problem with MOOCs, is that are we actually doing anything differently with the technology to what we did before? And that's, I think, the challenge for MOOCs. So I sit on the non-MOOC side of the world, and if you'd like to hear the argument for it, and you have access to a magazine called Educational Technology from last year, there is a wonderful article that argues for why MOOCs are no good. And it, but apart from that, I know that people actually do use them and are quite successful with it. But I think the concerns that the MOOC people have, that is of completion rates and keeping people amused and interested and interactions occurring, are real challenges that if we focus on more on the app, we can actually do something about. So that's my thesis. So the thing that's really important about apps is that each device that people have in this room will run most of common software app illustrations. And you can use similar apps in education and entertainment, productivity, and so forth. So there's a lot of ability to move files and share resources between different types of operating systems. One of the things that has made the whole move to app-based environments quite interesting is the way in which it allows generativity. That is, the capability to produce change through contributions that are not stymied by the sort of operating systems and the sort of monolithic mainframe systems that we currently run in most of educational contexts. That means that as a student with a smart device, I have a whole range of things I can do with that. I can actually collect data in the field. I can take images of real life events. I can share those. I can work collaboratively with others. I can create visual sequences and so forth. And so Zittrain in 2009 was basically suggesting that these five reasons are reasons why the move to apps is more likely to occur. And I leave those with you. The other themes about why we should consider moving in this direction is that often when people ask students which one they preferred, they often went, I would prefer tablets. And in fact, we conducted a study where we had over 100 teachers from different schools, and they were bribed to become part of this study by saying, we said to them, we'll give you $10,000 to spend however you like if you participate in the study and work together to achieve a final result. And the task they had was that they had to rework the curriculum and generate resources to teach that reworked curriculum. And it was working across, this was in schools, and I know most people here are not in schools, but it was working with elementary schools as well as high schools, secondary schools. And it's really interesting. When teachers got together in a group of half a dozen, which is what most of them were, and they were making choices about the sort of technology that would best help them teach a new curriculum in the classroom, invariably they chose to use tablets and ways in which you could use the Wi-Fi as a way of connecting and sharing. And the reason why they did that is, compared with most higher education or most larger organizations, they don't have any technical support. So as long as they've got a wireless access point, the rest of it can happen around it. And that's a really important aspect of that particular choice of technology. However, having just said that, teachers like the idea that there were studies that have occurred where students have rejected the whole idea of using tablets. However, the interesting thing is when students are given access to the tools themselves and have a device that they can use and they don't have to share with anybody else, suddenly they become much more interested. So I think it's a question of time till we see in learning environments that students will have their own resources and use them that way. So I think that we need to realize what's happening with the atomization of software by the creation of these apps. And the fact that they provide an environment in which we can use the tool to do some things and then move the resources onto another tool that allows you to modify it. I just thought I'd throw something else that had nothing to do with it into the presentation, so not everybody would be asleep or taking pictures of the slides. Anyway, the whole idea of atomization is taking a more complex set of processes and separating them out into components that enable you to save aspects of a file or aspects of some images or whatever the tool is into a shareable form. Often they can be PDF files or videos files and so forth. The interesting thing too is that these devices are often low cost and in some cases free, and so you can get access to these tools to do things with this smart device that it's not a major cost. And I think that's really rather important. There's also lots of other studies, and I think the thing that we've got to worry about is that a couple of the studies in more recent times found that some of the apps are pretty useless. I mean, has anybody downloaded an app and then played with it for half an hour and decided this is not of any use to me, I'm going to get rid of it? You probably wouldn't do that if you'd just paid, I don't know, 100 baht for it? I don't know, what's an average app downloading in Thailand? So? 10 per app. Well, that's pretty cheap. Okay. So the other thing too is that the people that have written the apps in a lot of cases tend to be 15-year-old schoolboys, and they do have a rather limited view of what a learning app is all about. Yeah, they eventually get better, but there are some apps that really do actually take off and become very useful, and I'd like to talk about some of that. One of the things that has been noted in more recent research is that when you get learning that is just happening irrespective of what you've got as the app and how it's working, then you've got some really interesting possibilities. And you've also got, with most apps and the way in which we use them with smartphones, people don't actually think about the technology. The technology sort of does things for us and allows us to take the pictures or allows us to put pictures together and create an animation or a movie or something like that. So they become invisible within what you're trying to do as a learner. And the other thing, too, is that you can get collaborative learning occurring, and this is as opposed to cooperative learning, by the fact that you can, with your app, create something, share it, and then somebody else will take that and modify it and add it, add to it and extend it. So that there's some interesting possibilities that, that the research has just been playing with. One of the key areas that, I hope I've been emphasizing is that there's a big push within the education systems to get students to think in terms of multiliteracies. That is, their ability to create visual sequences that are meaningful, that to create oral sequences, to put together solutions to problems. I mean, actually, it's really interesting. I was watching on the flight here. I flew Thai Airways, and there was a program about inventions of the king, and it showed different inventions and how they've improved life for and solved specific problems. A lot of them, sort of scientific type of problems. So I think that there's some real interesting possibilities here in getting our students coming through to think in terms of multiple ways of representing their idea and multiple sources of information for those ideas to be generated from. The other thing too, that the whole issue with using apps as part of innovations and distortions in a otherwise fairly coherent sort of argument is or environment is that you can very easily set challenges, problems. You can get people to think about design, share those designs with others, and so forth. So that, in a sense, they've broken the nexus where you had to use specific high-end packages to do some tasks. If some of you would think back and think about how we went around creating images for printing 10, 15 years ago, often we'd have to use a specialist application, and it took specialist skills to drive it and to get it to work for us. Whereas you can do amazing things now with some of the tools that are available as apps. The other thing too is because you have to use those apps in ways that are ones that you as a learner, you as a driver of this technology, have to think out for yourself. What it does mean is that you get more actively involved in thinking about problems and that you actually generate the solutions. If you think about it, most of the problems that we have when we're trying to teach is if you just leave a learning environment such that all people have to do is follow the text and learn various facts and then repeat them at the examination, it really doesn't require them to solve the problem or create an artifact that shows that they understand how something works. And yet all of these apps enable us to do those things. So I'm really encouraging you, if you are a user, to use it in as many different ways as possible and to think about ways of extending and going beyond the existing boundaries. And what I think essentially is quite important, and that's the last quote there, is getting students to do the thinking. The one thing about learning is that when students learn, they start thinking and they start coming up with new and creative outcomes. And I think that's the sort of thing that we want in many cases nowadays. One simple apps messing example is one where you sort of might do a storyboard with one piece of software. This is a little example. It's not a movie, unfortunately, but it's a storyboard of how this particular student came up with their particular answer. So there are things that you can do with apps, and these are some of the things. And think of them, all of them are not necessarily linked to one particular app. There are a lot of different apps that will do it. Mind you, having said that, there are some pretty terrible things out there, but and you can spend a lot of time getting lost. So we've got a possible process here that apps enable because of their very nature, that actually allows people to play with elements that go to a final solution. And this is one sort of flow chart that, would you believe, Microsoft is keen on pushing. But anyway, it shows you the way in which you can modify and change and end up creating and recreating and adding and extending particular tools. If you think of it another way, if you look at the five central ideas down here, when we're using these particular devices and particular pieces of software, we're capturing ideas, we're collecting evidence at various places, and the ways in which we do that now typically, say if students have got to measure stream flow or pollution or something like that, they can collect the evidence from the field. They then have to bring it back, organize it, make the case, sequence it. They then have to create some sort of artifact. And one of the things that is really exciting is that this whole way of thinking gets the students thinking about how can I put something together that will demonstrate that I understand this topic and that I've got a solution to the particular problem that I've identified. And that artifact is there. And so you don't have to mark them on did they get the right date and all that. They've got the artifact and it either works or it doesn't work. And then finally, that because of all of the other digital advantages, you can share that idea with other workers or other students. And what we tried to do here is we went through, and this is just some of the ways in which you can use tools or apps to create that process across different platforms, Android, iOS, and so forth. So it's device agnostic. So what I would like to say is really, I think if we think about app-enabled learning, it's a real shift away from infrastructure-led learning design, which is moving away from desktops and all those things that are wired in, into a time where you've got a way of providing for your students or for your own learning access to a tool that enables you to do different ways of representing things, to present arguments, to share, to work collaboratively and so forth. And I think this is the exciting thing that app-enabled learning allows us to work with. And unlike the fact that I insisted on using my computer rather than that computer, means that I can be a little bit more flexible and just operate independently. I leave you with those thoughts. Thank you very much for listening. I have taught for 3 years in Singapore and 2 years in Hong Kong, and I always threw out the notion to my classes that in my culture, if I don't get asked a question, I get very embarrassed in the sense that nobody thought it was of any importance. So I'm throwing that out to you, because if you feel that there was something of importance, let me know. Hasn't scared anybody yet.
Some how you know that the app, this one is good for learn or this one is not good for learn? Because the people, like the family, they have a lot of kids, right?
Yep.
So how you can say this app is good for every people or some kind, like this for young learner, this for adult, this for how? Mm-hmm. How?
I think you raise a very real question, a very difficult question to answer, because the thing that we do know is that there are a lot of apps that are out there that are not worth investing time in. I had two doctoral students who did a study for me looking at apps for mathematics learning for young kids. So looking at basically, you know, 5, 6 through to about 8. And they looked at a great number of apps. But the thing that they found was that most of them focus very much on drill and practice. Now, the kids are quite happy working with a drill and practice sort of strategy. But the big problem that they also found is that if the kids don't have a move to more problem-based or more open-ended sort of questions, what happens is that they just keep doing the same thing over and over again. And I think this is where, as a learner, as a parent, or as a teacher, we need to be very focused on, this is not extending me, I need to do something more than this. And I mean, I don't think it's an easy solution, I'm not saying it is, but I think that in more recent years, I've been working with groups of teachers across Australia. And the thing that I've been amazed by, those teachers that can look at an app and see ways in which they can use it in the classroom in a way that sets up problems or allows people to solve problems and challenges them to do it. And if you think about it, you can get apps which are very closed and the answer is always a certain number. But you can also get apps that basically they've got to really work to find the answer. And provided it, I mean, if you give students too much challenge, they may throw up their hands and say, look, this is too difficult for me. But it's really interesting. I worked with a grade 5 class when I was in Singapore, and we were doing a study on mathematics learning. And one of the real problems in primary mathematics, so grade 5 would be year 10, I mean age 10, something like that, maybe at 11. And we gave them a problem, which is one all of you probably have got through here, but 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds are really keen on mobile phones. And we asked them, can you tell us which of these three mobile phones would be the best mobile phone to have? And they leave it away, and you know, the kids work away for about half an hour. And at the end of the time, you know, one group put their hands up, well, we think it's this one. And then another group says, no, you're wrong, it's this one. And before giving them an answer, we sort of said to them, well, if I'm going to do a little bit of traveling, and I'm traveling a lot from Singapore to Malaysia or Thailand, and I want to do a lot of SMS messaging, which is the best plan? And they went back. They calculated. And another group came up, and they'd found an alternative solution. Now, this is a maths class. And for the first time, those kids realized that there wasn't a correct answer. They would just have to get the right answer given the conditions. And that really made them start to think. They started to realize what mathematics could do in ways that they never understood before. I just liked that because I thought that was marvelous to see. There anybody else? Yes.
Yeah. So. It's good that you highlighted the fact that mobile apps can bring a difference, to the learning of the students. I'm just wondering whether is there a policy in Australian schools not to, to disallow students from bringing their mobile phones? Because certainly I think in Indonesian public schools and in the Malaysian public schools, mobile phones are not allowed to be brought in. And the other thing is, even if they were allowed to be brought in, teachers have been saying that it takes a lot more time to use technology, especially in ways that you have just mentioned, than to just disseminate the information, because the curriculum is just too extensive.
Yes, we have the same problem in the sense that schools discourage it. In fact, there's one high school that doesn't let kids use computers until grade 10. But the thing is, everybody's got their opinions, but the big challenge is, as a teacher, you've got to spend time and effort getting the kids up to speed so that they can actually use the devices appropriately and effectively. And I think if you move from a didactic curriculum through to a more discovery or problem-based curriculum, most teachers find it takes a lot of time to get the kids settled. You may take 6 to 9 months, but if you crack that one, they then start to take control and start to take off. So it's a process that you've got to go through, and you've got to make sure that the devices are well used. I think the real challenge is for most teachers in schools to have a device that they understand enough to set a proper challenging task. And the thing is that I think the secret that I think was mentioned this morning really in the discussions was that the way you assess and the way you reward students' thinking is the thing that really makes the difference. And so as long as the assessment regime is well thought out, I think you can do some really interesting things. But thank you for the question, it's good. Is anybody else there? No? Yeah. If you want to email me and you want a copy of the presentation, please. I thought you might. I was racing to put this together and I didn't put the email down. But it's if you can look at in the program and look at my name, it's john.hedberg@mq.edu. .au. Yep. So I expect a lot of emails on Monday.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. And thank you to both speakers for a wonderful session. We'll take a break now. We're a little bit early, but we can start our break and then we'll come back at about 3:15. Thank you.